am Flash Isaac. Today, I shall be taking you through chemical equilibrium. Chemical equilibrium. What is chemical equilibrium? And how does it change the price of Gary in the market? Let us begin this way. Chemistry is the study of the composition, properties, and uses of matter. Now, properties of matter. Matter is anything that has mass and occupies space, and in terms of property, it exhibits physical and chemical properties. The physical properties of matter are the properties of matter that we can see or easily inspect. For example, the color, the texture, volume, density, boiling point, melting point. These are physical properties of matter. But chemical properties are only observed when matter undergoes change to form new substances. That is chemical properties of matter. This takes us to chemical reaction. Chemical reaction or chemical reactions occur when one or more substances referred to as reactants, let's say A plus B, are being converted to one or more substances referred to as products. This is the reactant part, and this is the product part. This is a chemical reaction. We can have just one reactant giving us two products, or two reactants giving us one product, or two reactants giving us three products. Irrespective of the number of reactants or of the number of products, so long we have reactants combining to form products, it is a chemical reaction. This side of the reaction is the reactant part, and the other side is the product part. Since in this case, we are dealing with an irreversible reaction. Irreversible reaction is a type of reaction that takes place only in one direction. It simply means that if A and B combine to give C and D, that is the end. You don't expect C and D to combine to give us back A and B. A good example of an irreversible reaction is combustion. Combustion is simply burning in the presence of oxygen. Let's look at hydrocarbon. C-S-H-Y. Where S is the number of carbon, Y is the number of hydrogen. If a hydrocarbon reacts with oxygen, we'll get carbon 4 oxide and water. Carbon 4 oxide and water are stable compounds, so they will not want to combine to give us back the hydrocarbon and oxygen. In this case, we leave this reaction as an irreversible reaction. It was believed that all reactions are irreversible until in 1808, when a French chemist, Claude Louis Berthollet, discovered or proposed the concept of reversible reactions. In that case, he was able to let us know that some reactions are reversible. For example, in the case of irreversible reaction, if A plus B react to give us C plus D. This is reactant part, arrow, and these are the product formed. Now take a look at the arrow and compare to this. In this case, the arrow is only going in the forward direction. In this case, the arrow is going both in forward and reverse direction. This simply implies that this reaction can happen in the forward direction, and it can take place in the backward reaction. This is like two-in-one reaction. A and B are combining to form C and D. C and D, on the other hand, are combining to form A and B. So for the forward reaction, we have A plus B to give us C plus D. For the backward or reverse reaction or reverse direction, we have C plus D giving us E plus B. So as A plus B are giving us C and D, C plus D are also giving us back A and B. So this forward goes, backward goes. For us to talk about a chemical equilibrium, then the reaction must be reversible. It is from the concept of reversible reaction that chemical equilibrium come about. Now look at something. If A plus B gives C and D, and C and D in turn give us A plus B, what do you think is, or what do you think is a factor, or what do you think can make reversibility of reaction possible? I think for reaction to be reversible, it must happen in a closed system, or the container must be closed. If not, if A and B react to give us C and D, and if it happens in an open system or in an open container, C or D or one of the products may escape, or one of them may react with oxygen, get oxidized, which means the backward reaction cannot take place. And another factor I feel that can make reaction reversible is that the products must not form crystals. The product should not form precipitate, rather, not crystal, which means trying to solidify, and the reaction should take place in a closed system. These are the factors that should support reversible reaction. Now, let's look at example. If nitrogen N2 gas react with hydrogen 3H2 gas, we simply have 2NH3 gas. So this is 2 nitrogen, 2 nitrogen, 6 hydrogen, 6 hydrogen. This is a reversible reaction. And this process is referred to as the Haber process. The Haber process is the process or industrial process of producing ammonia. So the process in the industry we use to produce ammonia is referred to as Haber process. And contact process is used to produce H2SO4. More of that on my videos on industrial processes. What does this mean? It simply means that if nitrogen reacts with hydrogen to form ammonia, ammonia formed can also break down to give us nitrogen and oxygen, which means the forward reaction N2 plus 3H2 give us 2NH3. There will also be a reverse reaction or backward reaction where we have 2NH3 to give us N2 plus 3H2. Now, take a look at a situation where an acid reacts with base to form salt and water. That is neutralization or acid-base reaction. If we have acid here plus base, then we have salt plus water. For an irreversible reaction, the acid and base, they will react, keep reacting. And as they are reacting, the concentration of the acid or of the reactant will reduce, because we are reducing the concentration of the reactant to form more of the product. That is irreversible reaction or in reaction. So after the reaction, you notice that A and B will be gone. We will now form salt and water. The concentration will increase. I'm trying to explain this chemical equilibrium diagram. In reaction, concentration changes with time. As more of the products are being formed, the concentration of the reactants will reduce. And as more of the products are being formed, the concentration of the product will increase. So taking a look at here, the concentration, the reactant started in full state. The acid plus base, they are complete, many, starting the reaction. So as the reactant, and before the reaction, product, concentration of the product, zero, because no product is formed yet. As the reaction takes place, you see that the concentration of the reactant goes down and the concentration of the product goes up. That is a normal behavior. But for a reversible reaction, you notice that as the reactants are combining to form products, the products are also combining to form reactants. It gets to a point whereby the rate at which the forward reaction is going is the same rate at which the backward reaction is going. It gets to a point whereby the concentration of the reactant does not change, the concentration of the product does not change, because the rate of the forward and backward reaction are equal. As the reactants are combining to form product, the products are combining to form reactant. Now, the stage whereby concentration of the reactants and products do not change is referred to as chemical equilibrium. As the reaction begins, the concentration of the reactants reduces, the concentration of the product increases. It gets to a point where you see the concentration remains constant with time. Concentration of the reactant doesn't change, concentration of the product does not change. This is because the rate of the forward reaction is equal to the rate of backward reaction. This is because the number of reactant molecules combining into products and the number of product molecules combining into reactants are the same. Now, what is chemical equilibrium? If you are asked chemical equilibrium, any of the definitions below will suffice or will be accepted. Chemical equilibrium is the process or the phenomenon where the concentration of the reactant and the concentration of the product do not change. Chemical equilibrium occurs when the rate of forward reaction is equal to the rate of the backward reaction. The way it's going forward is the same way it's going backward. They are equal. It is balanced. The number of reactant molecules converting into products and the number of product molecules converting into reactants are the same. So, ladies and gentlemen, we've been able to explain the concept of irreversible and reversible reaction. We've been able to explain or define chemical equilibrium. What is equilibrium? Is the state of a system when there is no observable change in properties with respect to time. When it comes to chemical equilibrium, we have two types of chemical equilibrium, which are the homogeneous equilibrium and the heterogeneous equilibrium. Before we focus on only the type of chemical equilibrium, let's take a look at equilibrium and the types or classification of equilibrium generally. Equilibrium can be static or dynamic. Static or dynamic. As the name implies, statics mean standing still, not moving. Equilibrium means there's a movement. A static equilibrium occurs when a system is at rest. There is no movement between the reactants and the products, and the rate of forward and backward reaction equals zero. When a system meets these three requirements, we simply say that the system is at a static equilibrium. Of course, when a system is at rest, no movement between reactants and products, and the rate of forward and backward reaction equals zero. This is a static or static equilibrium. How about dynamic equilibrium? Dynamic equilibrium can be divided into physical equilibrium and chemical equilibrium. In physical equilibrium, it only involves physical changes. Remember, in chemistry and in physics, we have two types of changes: physical changes and chemical changes. Physical changes are changes in which no new substances are formed. For example, burning of candle, melting of ice, no new substance is formed and they are reversible. Chemical changes, on the other hand, are changes in which new substances are formed. Therefore, physical equilibrium involves physical changes. An example of physical equilibrium is the vaporization of water. Water vapor from liquid to gas, from gas back to liquid, then they maintain a particular equilibrium when the forward reaction is equal to the backward reaction. Then we have the chemical equilibrium, which is our focus. Remember, chemical equilibrium is a state of a system where the forward reaction, the rate of the forward reaction is the same as the rate of the backward reaction. The concentration of the reactant and the product, they remain the same over time. Therefore, chemical equilibrium is divided into homogeneous equilibrium and heterogeneous equilibrium. In homogeneous equilibrium, all species involved in the reaction are in the same physical state, which means the elements of the compound reacting plus the product, everything are in the same state of matter. If they are liquid, they will all be liquid. If they are gases, they will all be gases. Examples: hydrogen gas reacts with iodine gas to form hydrogen iodide. Gaseous state, gaseous state, gaseous state. Nitrogen gas reacts with oxygen gas to form 2NO gas. 2SO2 gas reacts with O2 gas to form 2SO3 gas. Now, since we are dealing with equilibrium, all the reactions, therefore, must be reversible. You can see, reversible, reversible, reversible. Hydrogen iodide can react or can give us back hydrogen and iodine. So, the rate at which the forward reaction is taking place is the same rate at which the backward reaction is taking place. As more of the products are being formed, reactants are formed. So, going here, they are maintaining that balance. The concentration will remain the same over time. And in heterogeneous equilibrium, all the species involved are not in the same state of matter. Some of the species might be liquid, some gas, some solid, some gas, and so on. That is a heterogeneous equilibrium. Looking at carbon dioxide gas, carbon solid to give us CO gas. That is carbon monoxide. So we have gas, solid, gas. They are all not in the same state. Or limestone, solid, calcium oxide, solid, carbon dioxide gas. So solid, solid, gas. They are not in the same state of matter. So in summary, chemical equilibrium can be homogeneous equilibrium or heterogeneous equilibrium. In homogeneous equilibrium, all species are in the same physical state. In heterogeneous equilibrium, all species involved are not in the same state of matter. And this takes us to characteristics of chemical equilibrium. It is a dynamic process. Yes, it is not a static process, it is a dynamic process. There is a change. Reactants are being converted to products. Forward and backward reactions, they are taking place at the same rate. It is not a static process. And the concentration of reactants and products remain the same. It is achieved only in a closed system. To have for chemical equilibrium to take place, the reaction must occur in a closed system, because when you open it to atmosphere, the products may not be able to be converted, may not be able to go back to the reactant state. The backward reaction may not be favored. And at equilibrium, delta H is equal to T delta S. This is where I will recommend my videos on spontaneity of chemical reaction and the rate of chemical reaction. For reactions to occur spontaneously, there are certain factors that must be in place. Check out those videos. But delta H is enthalpy change, heat change in heat content of the system. Change delta H is heat content of the product minus heat content of the reactant. Then delta S is entropy change. Entropy is the degree of disorderliness, the degree of zagazaganess, the degree of randomness of a chemical system. So if delta H is equals T delta S, where T is temperature, then the system is at equilibrium. Now at equilibrium, delta G is zero. Delta G is Gibbs free energy. Gibbs free energy is the energy available for doing work. Is the energy available for making reactants turn into product. If this Gibbs free energy is zero, then the system is at equilibrium. And at equilibrium, the system resists change in factors governing the equilibrium. Ladies and gentlemen, let us proceed. Let's look at equilibrium constant and equilibrium constant equation. What is an equilibrium constant? Equilibrium constant is simply the ratio of the rate constant for to So as you can see here, equilibrium constant is simply Kf over Kb, where Kf is the rate constant for the forward reaction, and Kb is the rate constant for the reverse reaction. That is equilibrium constant. And how do we write equilibrium constants for reaction? Taking a look at this reaction, MA gas reacts with NB gas. This is what this is trying to tell you. A is the element or compound reacting. G is the state of the element. M here is the number of mole. Therefore, if I give you 2CO2 gas, M here is equals to, it represents the number of mole. G is the gas. We shall be representing the values with real elements and compounds soon for you to understand. But in this case, if A and B react to give us E and F, the equilibrium constant is simply the concentration of the products over the concentration of the reactants. When you write something like this in brackets, here is simply the concentration and the rest to the power of the number of moles. In this case, if we use CO2, let's say 2 here, P here is equals to, G here is the state, and E is the element or compound. So, dot F raised to the power of the number of moles of F all over A raised to the power of the number of moles of A, and B raised to the power to the number of moles of B. So, equilibrium constant is simply the ratio of the concentration of the product over the concentration of the reactants. And take note of this, solids do not appear in equilibrium constant. Why? Their concentration is taken to be unity or one. Since their concentration is taken to be one, they don't appear in equilibrium constant. To ensure that you understand, or to avoid the confusion you might have received from this expression, let's see a real question. This question says, write equilibrium constant for N2G plus 3H2G plus 2NH3G. So they are all in the same state. We can refer to this as homogeneous equilibrium. Now, the equilibrium constant is simply the concentration of the product. The product is NH3, ammonia. This is Haber process. Since we have just one product, we are not adding any other concentration. And what is the number of moles of the product, or what is the coefficient of the product? It is simply 2. So 2 here. Over the concentration of the reactants. The reactants are, here is the same thing as 1. So N2, concentration of N2 is the power of 1, dot, we have another reactant, H2, concentration of H2 is the power of 3. So you can see the coefficient or the number of moles is at the top. This is how you write equilibrium constant for reactions. Here, this is the concentration of the product, concentration of the reactants. And the next question says, write equilibrium constant for the reaction. Okay, we have another question before us. All these are to make us understand better. In this case, what do we have? We have CaCO3 solid to give us CaO solid plus CO2 gas. This is solid and gas, and we are asked to find the equilibrium constant. Remember, the equilibrium constant is the concentration of the product over the concentration of the reactants. Now, normally this would have been concentration of CaO, raise the power of 1, dot concentration of CO2, raise the power of 1, over CaCO3, concentration of CaCO3, raise the power of 1. Why 1, 1, 1? Because here, the number of mole is 1, or here, 1. So we use 1 for them. But solids do not appear in the equilibrium constant. Why? Their concentration is taken to be 1. This is because, since this is a solid, the concentration will be 1 dot CO2. This is a solid, the concentration is also 1. So therefore, 1 goes, it doesn't matter. So therefore, the equilibrium constant for this guy is simply the concentration of CO2. This is the answer. CO2 is just 1. If here were to be 2, then here will be 2. But since it's just 1, this is the equilibrium constant. Copy that. And the next question says, what is the order of the reaction? What is the order of the reaction? What is the order of the reaction? Now, I was waiting to use this question to explain order of reaction. If we are to write the equilibrium constant for this reaction, we will simply say that the equilibrium constant is equals the concentration of the product SO2 raised to the power of 2 state, and this is the compound, dot O2 raised to the power of 1. Over the concentration of the reactant. We have just one reactant, so this is simply SO3 raised to the power of 2. This is the equilibrium constant. Now, the order of the reaction is simply the power of the product. When you look at this equilibrium constant, you look at this product, what is the power 2? You look at this one, what is the power 1? So the order is equals 2 plus 1. This is simply 3. So the ones we've solved so far, to look for the order, just look for the concentration of the product or product, add the power. If it's just one product, check the power of the product. That is the order of the reaction. This takes us to Kc and Kp. Kc, they are Kp, they simply represent the if we are dealing with non-gaseous reactants or products, we use Kc to show the concentration. But if you are dealing with gases, we use Kp to show the partial pressure. Partial pressure is actually proportional to concentration. So Pv is equals nRT. Pv is equals T. So concentration is proportional to partial pressure. If you don't get it, forget about it. Just know that concentration is the same as partial pressure. So for gases, we use partial pressure, which means in this case, HEPA process gas plus 3 H2 gas to give us 2 NH3 gas, and we said the equilibrium constant is equals NH3 raised to the power of 2 over N2 raised to the power of 1 plus H2 raised to the power of 3. Since we are dealing with gases, instead of saying the concentration of ammonia, we simply say that this. So partial pressure of ammonia, partial pressure of nitrogen, partial pressure of hydrogen. When equilibrium constant is written in terms of concentration of the species involved, it is Kc. And when it is written in terms of partial pressure of the species involved, it is referred to as Kp. And there is a formula rating Kp and Kc. Kp is equals Kc bracket ROT raised to the power of change in mg. Take note of this formula. It relates Kp and Kc. Now, what is Kp? Like I said, when you express equilibrium constant in terms of partial pressure for gases, equilibrium constant in terms of concentration. Rho is molar gas constant. If you are dealing with ideal gas, the molar gas constant is the Rho we are dealing with here. And T is the absolute temperature. Temperature in Kelvin. If you are given temperature in degrees Celsius, convert to Kelvin by adding 273. Change in mg is simply change in number of moles, and we are dealing with gas. And change in number of moles is Np minus Nr. Np is the number of moles of gaseous product. Nr is the number of moles of gaseous reactants. If you subtract the number of moles of gaseous product from the number of moles of gaseous reactants, you get change in mg. So that is it, relationship between Kp and Kc. We started from the bottom, now we are here. Let's take a look at Le Chatelier's principle, which was proposed in 1884. This is the whole idea of Le Chatelier's principle. It simply tells us what happens to a system when something momentarily takes it out of equilibrium. Remember, in chemical equilibrium, the rate of the forward reaction is the same as the rate of the backward reaction. And the concentration of the reactant and product remain the same with time. They don't change. If an external factor or something or a constraint decide to take that system out of equilibrium, what happens? How does the reaction shift? What happens to the forward reaction? What happens to the reverse direction? Let's take a look at it. Before we do that, take note that catalyst doesn't affect equilibrium constant. Catalyst doesn't affect chemical equilibrium. Catalyst can only increase the rate of the reaction, the rate of forward or the rate of backward reaction, but it does not affect the equilibrium position. Once again, catalyst does not affect equilibrium position. It only increases or reduces the rate of reaction. Le Chatelier's principle states that if an external constraint is imposed on a system in equilibrium, the system will adjust itself in order to annul the effect of the constraint. If an external stress, external shaking or factor is imposed on the system already in equilibrium, the system will adjust itself to annul, to void, to counter this effect. Obviously, it has already told us what happens when there is a shaking in the system in equilibrium. Look at it. When if an external constraint is imposed on the system in equilibrium, the system will adjust itself in order to annul the effect of the constraint. What are the external constraints that can be imposed on the system in equilibrium? They are change in concentration, change in pressure, and change in temperature. These are the external constraints that can be imposed on the system in equilibrium. Let's take a look at this system in equilibrium. A plus B to give us C and D. What is the effect of change in temperature? The effect of change in temperature on a system in equilibrium depends on whether the system is endothermic or whether the system is exothermic. I already explained all this in under rates of reaction and spontaneity of chemical reaction. A system or a reaction that is endothermic is simply a reaction that needs heat from the environment to take place. It requires heat to be given for it to happen spontaneously. While an exothermic reaction is a reaction that gives out heat to the surrounding or to the environment. For exothermic reaction, the reaction vessel gets cooler. For endothermic reaction, the reacting vessel gets hotter because it absorbs heat from the environment. Now, for a reaction that needs heat or that requires heat from the environment, what happens when you increase temperature? Increase in temperature will simply favor the forward reaction. What now happens when you reduce the temperature? Reducing the temperature will favor the reverse direction or the reverse reaction. When we say a reaction is endothermic, it simply means that the forward reaction is endothermic. Meanwhile, the reverse is exothermic. When a reaction is exothermic, it only means that the forward reaction is exothermic, while the reverse is endothermic. Now, for a reaction that is endothermic in the forward direction, increasing temperature will favor the forward reaction or will favor the formation of the product, while reducing temperature will favor the reverse direction or will favor the backward reaction. So, increasing favors the forward reaction, reducing favors the backward reaction. Exothermic reaction is a reaction that gives out heat to the surrounding. It doesn't need heat, it gives out heat. Now, for a reaction that gives out heat to the environment, what happens when you increase the temperature? Increasing the temperature of exothermic reaction will favor the reverse reaction. Or more of the reactant will be formed when you increase the temperature. How about reducing the temperature? Reducing the temperature will favor the forward reaction. So, in summary, change in temperature affects a system in equilibrium depending on whether the reaction is endothermic or exothermic. For endothermic reaction, increasing temperature will favor the forward reaction. More of the product will be formed. Reducing the temperature will favor the reverse reaction or the backward reaction. For exothermic reaction, increasing the temperature we favor the reverse direction of the backward direction. More of the reactant is formed. While reducing the temperature, we favor the reaction in the forward direction. What is the effect of change in concentration? Before then, for endothermic reaction, delta H is positive. For exothermic reaction, delta H is negative. Now, change in concentration. Taking this to be a reaction in chemical equilibrium, increasing concentration simply means adding more substance, adding more species. So increase concentration of the reactant simply means to add more reactants. To increase the concentration of the product, it simply means adding more product. That will increase the concentration. Now, how does change in concentration affect a system in equilibrium? If this is a system in equilibrium, when you increase the concentration of the reactant, you will form more of the product, which means, one, increasing concentration of the reactant we favor the product. When you increase the concentration of the reactant, more of the product will be formed. When you increase concentration of the product, more of the reactant will be formed. Which means increasing concentration of one side will favor the other side. How about reducing concentration? When you reduce the concentration of the reactants, more of the reactant will be formed, which means it will favor the formation of the reactants. How about when you reduce the concentration of the product? Reducing the concentration of the product, more of the product will be formed. So that is the effect of concentration on chemical equilibrium. Effect of change in pressure. Change in pressure takes place if and only if the number of moles of the reactants and the product are different. If number of moles not equal, or if change in energy is not equal to zero. So for concentration to affect a reaction or to affect gaseous reaction, the concentration or the volume of the product must be different from the volume of the reactant, or the number of moles of the reactant must be different from the number of moles of the product. Now look at this. Looking at this reaction, they are all gases. This implies that there's a chance that change in pressure will affect the system. But look at something. How many moles of nitrogen do we have? One. How many moles of oxygen? One. How many moles of NO? Two. So what is the total number of moles or total volume of the reactant? Two. What is the total number of moles or total volume of the product? Two. Since the total volume or total number of moles of the reactant is the same as the total volume of the product, pressure will not affect this reaction. So change in pressure will not affect equilibrium. So if you are asked which of the following equilibrium constant will pressure not affect, it is simply when they are all gases and the number of moles of the reactant is equal to the number of moles of the product. But once they are all gases and the volume of the product, let's say if here we have 3, the total number of moles here will be 4 and here will be 2. Therefore, pressure will affect this, will shift the position of equilibrium. Now take a look at this. What is the effect of increasing pressure on N2 gas plus 3H2 gas to give us 2NH3 gas? So these are gases. The reactants are gases. The product is a gas. Once again, Haber process. This is one. So the total number of moles or volume of the reactant equals 1 plus 3. 1, 3, 2. So 1 plus 3 is 4. Here, number of moles or the volume is 2. Now, do we have the same change in energy is equals 4 minus 2 or 2 minus 4? That is 2 or minus 2, which is you are subtracting the number of moles of the reactant from the number of moles of the product. Since it is not equal to zero and they are all gases, pressure will have effect. But how does it happen? What happens when you increase pressure of this reaction? Increase in pressure we favor the side with smaller volume. Increase in pressure will favor the side with smaller volume. Looking at this and this, we have a bigger volume here, 4 moles. We have 2 here. So increasing pressure here will favor the forward reaction. So how about reducing pressure? Reducing pressure or decreasing pressure will favor the side with bigger volume, which means in this reaction, when you reduce the pressure, it will favor the reverse reaction. So once again, increasing pressure will favor the side with smaller volume. Reducing pressure will favor the side with bigger volume. If here were to be 6, and here is 6, increasing pressure would have favored the backward reaction because we have lesser volume at the backward reaction. And reducing pressure will favor the forward reaction because we have bigger volume in the forward reaction. So ladies and gentlemen, we've known the effect of temperature, pressure, and concentration on the equilibrium constant. And the relationship between standard free energy and equilibrium constant is simply delta G theta is equals minus rho T ln K. So the gas constant, this is the standard free energy, and this is the equilibrium constant. So this is the relationship. T is absolute temperature. This is the relationship between delta G theta and equilibrium constant. So let's see the application of equilibrium or chemical equilibrium in the industry. In summary, chemical equilibrium or reversible reaction has really helped the industry. It helps us to know the things to adjust to form more products or to form more reactants. For example, in Haber process, ammonia is being formed. So you ask yourself, how do we increase the formation of ammonia, or how do we favor the production of the reactants? So what do we do to achieve equilibrium? You see, so asking this question helps us to get more of the products or more of the reactants, depending on what we look forward to achieve. Industrial applications of chemical equilibrium and questions we shall be answering. The first application of chemical equilibrium in industry is preparation of ammonia by Haber process. This is a reversible reaction. N2 plus 3H2 to give us 2NH3. And this is an exothermic reaction. Delta H is negative. Heat is given off. And the second application of chemical equilibrium in industry is preparation of sulfuric acid by contact process. SO2 plus O2 to give us SO3. This is an exothermic reaction. Now, we know that chemical equilibrium is very important in the industry. It helps us to know how to improve the product or how to get more of the reactant. In Haber process, preparation of ammonia, how do you think we can increase the yield of NH3? From the knowledge we've gathered so far, let's look at the constraint, the factors: concentration, temperature, and pressure. Looking at temperature, will temperature affect this reaction? Yes, temperature will affect it. This is an exothermic reaction. Since we need more of ammonia, we need to reduce the temperature. Reducing temperature will increase the forward reaction, and more of the product will be formed. How about pressure? They are all gases, and the volume or number of moles of reactants is 1 plus 3, that is 4, and that of product is 2. And remember, increasing pressure will favor the side with lower volume or the side with lower number of moles. Therefore, to increase the yield of ammonia, we have to increase the pressure. And concentration, like we already know, increasing concentration of reactant favors more of the product. Increasing concentration will favor the opposite side. What else should we do? Addition of catalyst. Addition of catalyst does not affect the equilibrium position, but it makes the reaction occur faster. So the catalyst used here is finely divided iron. And look at this reaction. Since it is an exothermic reaction, reducing temperature will favor the product formation. They are all gases. Increasing pressure will favor the formation of SO3 and addition of catalyst. Now in ammonia, in Haber process, the temperature is, we reduce the temperature to 450 degrees Celsius. This is a very high temperature. Thus, the question, low temperature is required to increase ammonia production in Haber process. Why do industrialists still use as high as 450 degrees Celsius since we need low temperature? Answer, in this reaction, since it is exothermic, we need a low temperature to increase the yield of ammonia. However, we cannot reduce the temperature to around 350 degrees Celsius, like in contact process. We therefore drop it to around 450 degrees. This is because if the temperature is very low, more of the product will be formed, but the equilibrium will not be reached. We therefore need to reach equilibrium. Therefore, we use 450 degrees Celsius. Ladies and gentlemen, chemical equilibrium. That is it. I hope you found this class helpful. I am Flash Isaac. And don't forget to subscribe to this channel. Turn on the notification bell. Tell your friends about Flash Learners. Thank you.